We've had a few weeks off in the book of Romans, and last week I covered my conference topics in Revelation chapter 6 and chapter 7, and we did that all Sunday last week, but I want to get back into Romans now here in Romans chapter 8 and take these sessions here this morning and wrap up this section, and therefore next week, I'll only teach the first session. We're going to have a missionary come in and share about his work. He's also coming to celebrate Brother Dirk's birthday, the celebration that they're going to have next week. But we're also going to give him the pulpit, and he's going to share about their work, and he's also going to teach as well. So next week, I'll teach on Romans chapter 8, and we'll introduce our next section here in Romans chapter 8, verses 26 through 30, and then we'll be proceeding on in connection with that. But I want to cover these next two verses here in Romans 8, 16 through 25, specifically verse 24 and 25, and kind of wrap this all up and tidy it all up for what it is, and review, get us back in the swing of things, and then, like I said, wrap it up. But we'll start by reading the verses. Verse 16 through 25, and then I'll pray, and then we'll get into it this morning. Romans chapter 8, verse 16. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for this time that we have to come together here in this building, knowing that the most important thing is not necessarily the building, but the members of the body of Christ as we gather together. And as we gather together for a specific reason and a specific purpose, the reason is your word, you, through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and the purpose is to learn more about you, to grow in our understanding of you in time past, but now and in ages to come, and to know more about that cross work, of all that was done in the cross and all that was provided by it. And Father, we thank you that we can gather together, that we can open up this precious book, the living words of the living God, and to learn more about you through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, specifically in this passage, our hope, our inheritance, the glory and the life that is to come, and the fruit that it produces in the life that now is. It's patience, it's strength, it's comfort, it's joy, it's power. All those things, Father, that we can benefit from now, even in the most dire of situations and circumstances that we are in or that we ever may be in, the sufferings of this present time, and that we can all utilize it. We can utilize it all and have it work together for good, for glory in the life that is to come. So, Father, I pray that we would be heavenly minded, that we would be hope oriented, that we would know these details so that we would reckon them all the days of our life, and that we would reckon them when we go through a suffering, and that we therefore would benefit from the supply of the Spirit that is given to us here in this section of Romans chapter 8. We give you all the thanks and praise for all that your Son has provided us, and what you have provided for us in your Son. So in his name we pray. Amen. Again, we are here in Romans chapter 8, and we're dealing with this section of information that follows the details of what it means to walk after the Spirit and how we do that. And this section is communicating to us what our purpose is, the reason and the purpose for walking after the Spirit, the reason why God didn't just take us up right away the moment we believed, why he's left us here, why he's provided us the Spirit, why the Spirit leads us, why we're his sons and daughters. And it all has to do with glory. It all has to do with our inheritance. It all has to do with something that's yet future. And therefore, what he's doing now works for the future. There are some things that we automatically benefit from the moment we have trusted Christ as our all-sufficient Savior, how they died for our sins, was buried, and rose again. Some things that have to do with our inheritance, things that have to do with glory, and things that we are expecting to come in the future. But when it comes to our walk, there are things that in relationship with our walk, as we walk after the Spirit, work for us things in the life that is to come. And we're starting to learn more about what that is. And our purpose relates to the heavenly places, specifically the creature. And the creature has functional life. It is played out with the angelic realm up there. Currently, it's in subject to vanity. It's in the bondage of corruption. And the ones whom God is going to utilize to deliver it from the bondage of corruption is the children of God. And we can participate in various aspects of the creature in the life that is to come. And therefore, everything that we learn here and we will learn from here on out relates to the life that is to come, relates to that inheritance and to that glory and to that purpose. And Paul has embedded our purpose, our hope, and our glory. He's embedded it in the context of the sufferings of this present time. Because although we're going to walk after the Spirit in this life, and it's going to work for us things in the life that is to come, Paul, as well as the Spirit, wants us to know, and our Heavenly Father wants us to know, that these things work even in sufferings. And therefore, there is nothing that goes to waste in regards to what God can use for the life that is to come. If he can utilize sufferings for the life that is to come, he can use the lack of sufferings for the life that is to come. And he has spelled out to us what we need to reckon when we are in sufferings. We are to reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. And as we've gone down and we've looked at the creature, we've looked at our hope, we've looked at our deliverance of it, the life we're going to bring it, and those kind of things, and we've dealt with the detail of that, that provides us to be able to say with Paul that very thing. That the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. And there's something else that should have the preeminence in our minds when we go through sufferings, other than the adverse effects of sufferings that can take place in our minds. And we'll talk a little bit more about that as we get down here into verse 24 and 25. And we've talked about, therefore, what that hope, the glory, the inheritance, and the expectation of something future, the life that is to come, what that can do now. It's supposed to have impact now. And we've talked about that in connection with the first fruits of the Spirit. And we've dealt with some of those things, the long suffering that it's able to produce. We'll deal with that once again here in verse 25, the patience, the strength, the power, the comfort. We're going to see its help to us. There's joy that can be produced by these things of the Spirit when we're in sufferings, because we're not thinking about the sufferings, even though they're real, it hurts, it doesn't feel good, but the future and the prospect of the future and the absolute reality that that is supposed to be more highly esteemed in us. And when we think about that, that's where the joy can enter in, not in the pain. That hurts. That's not joyful. That doesn't feel good. But the joy is derived from and is produced by the things of the Spirit regarding the glory and the life that is to come. And lastly, we left off talking about one of those things, the redemption of our body. And we talked about how Paul has basically framed this all in, this glory in our inheritance. He's framed it in by two things, the manifestation of the sons of God and the redemption of our bodies. The very first thing, which is the last thing that he's mentioned here in this section that is going to take place at the resurrection, is the redemption of our body. And we've talked about what our bodies have been sown in now in weakness and dishonor and in corruption, and how they'll be raised in incorruption, they'll be raised in power, they'll be raised in glory. And we've talked about some of those things and the new body. Our vile body shall be fashioned unto like his glorious body, as he says there in Philippians chapter 3. And we've talked about some of those changes that are going to take place and the influences that take place on our body now just by nature and having the sin nature still, as well as the sufferings and the adverse effects of sufferings that can take the toll on the body, how that will be changed. And that won't be the situations and up there in the life that is to come in eternity. That's not going to be the fashion up there. There's a fashion now that's passing away. But there's going to be an eternal fashion up there in regards to glory and regards to our body. And then we're going to go to the judgment seat of Christ. We'll be judged for the things done in our bodies, the things that we've placed there that's supposed to be the things of the Spirit, the gold, silver, precious stones. And we'll give an account. And out of that, we will receive a reward. It's a reward of glory, in other words. And we'll be fully unblameable, fully unreprovable in His sight, in the Father's sight. Not only in regards to our position in Christ, but in regards to our walking after the Spirit. And He will reward us or not. Or you can talk about reward in two ways. You can get rewarded something good. You can be rewarded something bad. And Paul talks about both. And the reward that He'll give us glory is going to be manifest in our bodies. It's going to be evident in our bodies. Just as much as, not just as much, but just like you can see that God, will be able to see that God is the most glorious being in all of the universe. Not only do we get to know that now through the lens of Scripture, but one day we'll get to see that physically, that He is most glorious. And we know that from the Scripture, that when people have encountered the presence of God and have seen His glory, that they fall down as dead. Because a man can't see the glory of God. The only way in which they can see Him is when God comes along and He touches them, He cleanses them, He sanctifies them, as it were, to be able to see Him in his glory and those kind of things. And that too, that physical, that manifestation will be resident and be manifest in our new redeemed bodies. In other words, we're all going to receive the glorified, resurrected body. But there will be glory that will be added to that in connection with our walk, our reward, that will be further manifested in our bodies. It's like if you think about in regards to the our military and those kind of things, they all get the military garb. They all get the military garments and those kind of things, if my understanding is correct. But then you get the glory of it based upon certain things you've gone through and those kind of things. You get the medals and the pins, and each one of those, although I don't understand what they mean, in the military they do. And that officer or that soldier can come in to a room and those other soldiers can look, not only that they have the garments on, but they got the pins and the clips and the medals and those kind of things, and they therefore know the authority that they are dealing with, and they therefore know their place. And there will be something, not exactly, but something like that up there in the heavenly places in connection with the principalities, the powers, the mights, thrones, and dominions that He's going to place us into based upon our walking after the Spirit and what we've built up in our inner man and how we've built it up and how we've proved it in the details of our life. And we've talked about those things in connection with the redemption of our body. What I want to now do is turn to verse 24 and 25. All the things that we've covered in the preceding verses, when we've gotten here now to verse 24, constitutes along with things that go back further on in the earlier on in the book of Romans, constitutes our hope. And you have to be able to think about it that way. Our hope is not just the issue of eternal life. It is that. It's not just the issue of being present with the Lord. It is that. Our hope constitutes a new body. Our hope constitutes being a part of the creature and delivering the creature from the bondage of corruption. Our hope constitutes going to the judgment seat of Christ and coming out of it with a reward. If we follow what the Spirit's leading us in Paul's epistles, and there's so much more of our hope. When we specifically just look at the redemption of our body, you can have various details that constitute just that element of our hope. One element of the hope is the body. One element of the hope is the heavenly places. One element of the hope is the life that we're going to be manifesting up there for all eternity. And you can look at that with a magnifying glass, the redemption of our bodies, and you can look at the issue of it's our bodies now are sown in weakness, but to be raised in power. And you can look at the issue of the heavenly places, and you can put a magnifying glass to the heavenly places and see that there's places up there. And that there's positions of authority in those places, principalities, powers, might, thrones, and dominions. And you can look at the life that we're going to be manifesting up there. You can look at the love and the wisdom and the justice and the judgment that we're going to be and hopefully be executing up there. And you can look at each one of those with a further magnifying glass to see its details. All of that constitutes our hope. And Paul's going to come now along and say that that does something for us now in sufferings. And this is what he says it does. Verse 24. For we are saved by hope. He says, for we are saved by hope. He's giving further explanation and amplification upon what all of this is. The issue of suffering with him, verse 17, at the end, that we may be also glorified together. In verse 18, the glory which shall be revealed in us, the incomparable glory that shall be revealed in us to that of the sufferings that we experience in this present time. The verse 19, the earnest expectation of the creature waited for the manifestation of the sons of God. And the hope there that the Father has subjected the creature in when he subjected it to vanity. The delivering of the creature from the bondage of corruption to the glorious children, the glorious liberty of the children of God. The expectation and the groaning that we now have for the redemption of our bodies. That's our hope. And that hope is designed to save. And that saving here in verse 24, this saving here goes all the way back up to the issue of what essentially verse 18 is designed to do. In other words, when you are to reckon, when you reckon and you have some things to back up that reckoning, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. He's looking at the suffering. He knows what can come along with suffering, and he's looking at the glory and how that glory is his hope, and he's reckoning it that's not worthy to be compared. And the comparison is taking place in the mind. And that's exactly where the salvation takes place. Our hope is able to save our minds. If you've ever been in a suffering in one way or another, you can, even the smallest of sufferings. You know, we've had a sickness going through our house. We finally don't have it anymore. But it was like all the month of January, you know, into February or something, you know, and you kind of get laid up inside your house, and you know, just being cooped up in your house can drive you a little nuts. It's just something so small like that, but in our bodies that we're in, and the frailness of our bodies, either one, you got to sleep a lot, or you just got to lay around because you can't move very much. And two, you're just don't getting that fresh air. You're not getting the sun. All these things that give energy and power to our mortal bodies now, that if we don't have that, how that can impact us mentally, how that can impact our minds. And what we begin to esteem is the sufferings, how hard it is and how tough it is and those kind of things. And we're not thinking about, this isn't always going to be this way. I'm going to get a new body that's never going to get sick. And I'm not going to be cooped up in my house. I'm going to be in the heavenly places. And it doesn't take away completely and totally the things that come with the pain. But man, it can lessen it because of what's going on in the mind. One of the things I do with Abby and Saya, you know, you probably heard those jokes before when someone, you know, has stubbed their toe. My friends, when we were in grade school and stuff, we would do this. You get hurt, you stub your toe, and they would punch you in the shoulder and say, well, now your toe doesn't hurt, you know, because the pain has gone somewhere else. I'll do that to my children. I didn't mean to say that. But when they have a cut or something, I try to get their mind on something else. It doesn't take away the cut. It doesn't take away the pain to the cut. But because their mind is not just completely, or not to have them look at it, you know, look at the blood, you know, when, they'll be fine. And then when they see the blood, oh my goodness. Because their minds are registering, there's the blood right there. Blood means bad or something. And they just go crazy. And it's so small. And they're completely fine before they saw it because of things going on in the mind. And that to the nth degree, to the most godliest of degrees, is what this information is designed to do. It doesn't heal the cut. It doesn't heal the suffering. It doesn't deliver us from it. There's a salvation in it. There's an endurance. There's a strength that God's word is able to give to us in it when we're experiencing it. That's what he's talking about. Now, he says, for we are saved by hope. This salvation is not the salvation from the debt and penalty of our sins. I believe he used the word I guess he didn't use the word. If you go over to, he uses it over there. He uses justification. He uses it in Romans chapter 1. If you look at Romans chapter 1 and look at verse 16. When we first dealt with this information, the focus, and rightly so, is the salvation when it comes to righteousness and justification. But what we're starting to see now is that the gospel of Christ has more than one salvation in it. And I'm not meaning there's more than one way to be saved. I'm not saying that. I'm saying once you believe the gospel of Christ, you're saved from the debt and penalty of your sins, but the gospel isn't just being that Christ died for your sins, was buried, and rose again so you could be justified. It was that he could give you everything else. Remember, Christ died for our sins, he was buried, and he what? Rose again. What's the basis on which we're going to have the redemption of our bodies? The resurrection. Because he rose from the dead, we will rise. And that resurrection of our bodies is part of our hope. And so the gospel of Christ, although when we first looked at it, what Paul concerned himself in connection with it is what it yielded in regards to righteousness, to be able to be right in God's sight and be justified and be saved from the debt and penalty of our sins. But the totality of the gospel, the death, burial, and resurrection, when you look at the resurrection, there's another issue that it can save us. And oftentimes, people talk about salvation and those three tenses, right? You're saved from the debt and penalty of your sin. You're being saved from the power of sin. And you'll be saved from the presence of sin in the future. And they talk about that. And there's nothing wrong with that. And Paul talks about that in various places. But the gospel of Christ, which is the power of God unto salvation. The salvation, there's a lot of salvation that we get. Not just the salvation from the debt and penalty of our sin. Now, we didn't see that when we were here. But now, as we're in Romans chapter 8, looking back, we start to see that there's a lot more that God, and it's just the way our Father is. He's got a lot more up his sleeve than when that meets the eye when we first go through some information. And I hope to share those things with you as we keep going on. But look at verse 16. It says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as is written, the just shall live by faith." Again, in this context, he's specifically dealing with the issue of being righteous, having the righteousness of God. But there's more salvation that the gospel has in connection with the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. But this salvation that Paul's talking about here, you can turn back to Romans chapter 8, this being saved, for we are saved by hope. That's what hope can do. It can save us. That's what Paul says it is. He's just stating it as a fact here. This salvation is dependent upon having that first salvation. You can't get this one unless you have the first one. This salvation, this one comes after being saved from the debt and penalty of your sins. Paul talks about it all over the place. We won't turn there, but 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18, he talks about the preaching of the cross, which we are who are saved, it is the power of God. He says in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 15, that we are the sweet savor of Christ in them that are saved. He says in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 5 and verse 8, "For by grace are ye saved, by grace are ye saved through faith." In 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4, "Who will have all men to be saved." 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 9, "Who hath saved us." Titus chapter 2, verse 11, "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men." Titus 3, verse 5, "But according to his mercy he saved us." That regards from the debt and penalty of our sins. That's not what this one is. Because with that one, we're saved by grace through faith in the cross. This one, we're saved by what? Hope. Hope. It comes after that one. But we're saved by hope. Now that we are saved from the debt and penalty of our sins, we have access to this grace of hope that also provides a salvation in the sufferings of this present time. So, saved or save or salvation can have, there's many different kinds of them. The definition allows for it. The definition of being saved is to preserve from injury, destruction, or evil of any kind. And again, it's the context that will dictate where the salvation takes place. Where it takes place and the kind that it is. Notice he does not say, "For we are saved by healing." He does not say, "For we are saved from sufferings." He doesn't say that we're going to be saved from hardships. He says we're saved by hope. And so we have to, again, make sure that we're staying within the context. And we already know that we're going to go through the sufferings of this present time. That's one of the ways we suffer with him. And so, in one sense, we're appointed to suffering. Look at that. Look at 1 Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians. And look at chapter 3. First Thessalonians chapter 3, look at verse 1. It says, "Wherefore, when we could no longer forbear," I love that. One of the things that has just been popping out over and over in my reading lately is Paul longing for the saints. He just could not get enough. He says to the saints at Rome, "For I long to see you." And over and over and over again, he tells the Philippians, "For I long after you with the bowels of Jesus Christ." Just as much as Jesus Christ loves us and longs to see us and wants us, so too did the Apostle Paul. And that's the very same thing that we are to have for one another. And he gets to this point where he says, wherefore we could no longer forbear. We thought it good to be left at Athens alone and sent Timotheus, our brother. Paul couldn't forbear seeing them or hearing from them or something. So he stays at Athens and he sends to them Timotheus, our brother and minister of God and our fellow laborer in the gospel of Christ, to establish you. That's part of what Paul longed for. Not only to long to see them, and he could no longer forbear to see them, but he wanted to establish saints. He wanted to see their maturity in the doctrine and the knowledge, and not only that, but that be sounded out in the world and that be proved in the details of their lives with one another. He says, and to comfort you concerning your faith. See how he switches here now. Part of the establishing that we're getting in Romans chapter 8, and the comfort, Paul hears word of what's going on in Thessalonica, and he also knows that when they were there, when he first came to them, that he came to them in afflictions, and he was wondering if they were going to continue on with it, knowing and seeing what Paul was going through. And now he leaves them, and now he hears word that and knows what's going to take place with them. And so he couldn't forbear. His concern was their ability, the ability of their faith, to build them up so that they can endure some things, because it wasn't going to be easy. And he says that he wanted to establish them and comfort them concerning your faith. And look what he's going to move into, verse 3. That no man should be, what's that next word? Moved by these, what? Afflictions. And one of the grounds for him saying that is what he's going to say next. For yourselves know that we are appointed thereunto. You're appointed. This is completely contrary to what usually Christianity talks about when it talks about suffering. They skip these verses. You're appointed, or they want to categorize it. This is both the sufferings of this present time and the sufferings of Christ. The sufferings of this present time come from no longer God operating with the world under the law. And if you disobey, then there's curses and suffering. And if you obey, there's no curses and no suffering. He's not dealing with the world under the law anymore. Rather, now it's the reap what you sow issue, and we live in the sin-cursed world and the ramifications on it, and we live in these mortal bodies, and we live amongst this evil world, and there's going to come sufferings. And when you obey, the opposite is true under grace than it is under the law. When you obey and you begin to live godly in Christ Jesus, you shall suffer what? Persecution. So it's not when you obey now you get victory over your enemies and you get all that you want and all that you needed. Now, that's not true. Most likely the opposite is going to happen. And so you have the things that just take place by the natural course of things, the sufferings of this present time. God's appointed us to that. We're not under the law in the sense that when we obey, we're not going to suffer those things, the hardships and the sufferings. That's why they're called the sufferings of this present time in connection with the dispensation of God's grace in which we live. As well as when we obey, we'll also be suffer for that as well. That's part of suffering with Him. And He says He's appointed us thereunto. And the knowledge and the understanding of that is supposed to help you in not being moved by them. But not only that, is he wants to comfort them. He wants to comfort them. And that comfort is designed to work so that they're not moved. To be established, to be grounded and rooted in the doctrine. That when the sufferings come and they're designed to move you and uproot you, that you are established in the knowledge and in the doctrine, and you have a great hope that's doing that. It's saving you. It's like a tree when there's a tornado coming, and those roots, if they're down deep and they're really rooted, come what may, that tree is not going to move, and those roots save that tree from the suffering of that storm. And when we have the doctrine rooting us and establishing us, when the sufferings come, we won't be moved. Now, if you are moved, that doesn't mean you're not saved from the debt and penalty of your sins. It's not what we're dealing with. It just means that you've been moved and you're going to then be in a state of turmoil. You're going to be suffering then, not only the actual suffering, but the instability of your mind. Depression and despondency and distress and all the other things that can come along with going through suffering. And Paul's telling the saints at Thessalonica, he sends Timotheus, he wants to know, and he's give them some things, but he wants to make sure that they have not been moved. Verse 4, "For verily when we were with you, we told you before that we should suffer tribulation, even as it came to pass, and ye know." Now here he's going to focus upon the specific sufferings of Christ here that the adversary brings against us for our living godly in Christ Jesus. Verse 5, "For this cause, when I could no longer forbear, I sent to know your faith, lest by some means the tempter have tempted you and our labor be in vain. But now when Timotheus came from you unto us and brought us good tidings of your faith and charity," notice that, now he switches up, he comes to know their faith, that they're not being moved, that they believe they're in their hope, and that hope is rooting them and grounding them when they're suffering the afflictions and the tribulation. But now he comes along and he sends Timotheus, that's all he wants to know is their faith, and Timotheus comes back knowing, not only knowing their faith, but their faith in their what? Charity. And we've talked about this before, that this long suffering that we can have, oftentimes when we're in a suffering, that it affects us so much that we become self-minded because we're thinking about our pain. And no one would come along and say you're not justified in doing that. It's hard. I wouldn't wish that upon anyone. I wouldn't want you to go through that and all those kind of things. But so much point where it's just what's going on with you, and what, and again, this is a little bit different when it comes to these persecutions. This isn't, you know, the Thessalonica is on their, you know, on their deathbed and they're dying. It's not like that, where they can't actually physically do something to someone else. So it's not that, but they could still come along and, like the Corinthians, get the pressure, get the sufferings, and think about themselves, and then back out and just think about themselves. These saints at Thessalonica were suffering, and their faith was so strong that they didn't just faint and start thinking about themselves and how hard things were impacting them. They continued to be charitable to one another. They continued to think about others, even when they deserve to be thought about, if that makes sense. And Paul is just ecstatic because all he was looking for is they're not moved. And now he sees the Word of God working. And that's why he's going to go on in chapter 4 and start talking about their charity and how it's working in them. I'll show you that here in a second. He says, "And brought us good tidings," verse 6 in the middle, "of your faith and charity, that ye have good remembrance of us always." They're remembering what Paul taught them, what Paul did when he entered in. He entered into Thessalonica in afflictions, but Paul didn't come along and say, "Here, just protect me," and all these kind of things, and didn't do anything. No, he gave them the doctrine. He was charitable unto them. He, as a father, exhorted and charged them. As a nurse, he nourished them and cherished them, it says in chapter 2 of 1 Thessalonians. He loved them to give them the gospel, to give them the doctrine, and then he manifested that love even when he was in persecutions and afflictions were following after him. And the Thessalonians looked at that and they had good remembrance always of Paul and those that were with him. And they had the faith and the charity. And he says, "Desiring greatly to see us, and we also to see you." So they had such a desire for one another. And it was based upon the doctrine. It says, "Therefore, brethren, we are comforted over you in all our affliction and distress by your faith." It's one of the ways in which God's going to comfort us. Paul is in affliction, they're in affliction. But the good tidings are is they're not being moved. And that comforted Paul. And Paul not being moved, that comforted the Thessalonians. Even so far, he says this in verse 8, "For now we live if ye saints, ye Thessalonians, stand fast in the Lord." That's what this information is designed to do for us, first and foremost. What it's designed to do is it's designed for us to be able to stand fast in sufferings, not be moved, to endure. What he's going to talk about is patience. That's the salvation that it provides us. Not from it, but in it. And then what it's also going to do is it's going to be able, when you see someone in the faith standing fast in their sufferings, and all those fruits of the Spirit and the supply of the Spirit is being manifest in their life, that's comforting you. And that's provoking you to stand fast in the sufferings that you're going through. Verse 9, "For what thanks can we render to God again for you?" Paul was, he was so thankful. He had no thanks left in the tank. I mean, he has exhausted his thanksgiving for these saints. "For all the what?" Is that what we talked about? One of those things that can come out of this passage in Romans 8? The joy. "For all the joy wherewith we joy for your sakes before our God, night and day praying exceedingly that we might see your face and perfect that which is lacking in your faith." I was reading this the other day. I was like, do I think about all of you this way? Do we think about each other this way? Night and day praying exceedingly to see one another. We know that we're going to usually see each other on Thursdays and Sundays. And so we kind of have that assurance that that's going to take place. But is that fervent zeal and desire for one another there? And not only just to see one another, but Paul, to these, and we can do this with one another, is perfect that which is lacking in your faith. The relationship that they had. Well, I said I was going to talk about the love issue a little bit more, but you can read chapter 4 and talk about that. I'll just look at one verse. Look at chapter 4, verse 9. He says, "But as touching brotherly love, ye need not that I write unto you, for yourselves are taught of God to love one another." Paul came along and gave them the fundamental principles of charity. And they understood that charity, they understood that love, and they took that and they ran with it. To the point where Paul comes along and says, God taught you how to love one another, to take these things and to do it. Paul didn't have to come along and say, okay, now we got the fundamentals down, now this is what you can do with it. They took it and they saw what they can do with it. And the testimony of that was in their sufferings, they didn't come along and say, I'm in a need, I need you to help me. They just did that. And when one was in a need, they still helped someone else because they just loved. Then that charity was abounding and that mind of Christ was in them so much. Well, did I tell you to go one other place? I don't think so. You can turn back to Romans chapter 8. On your way back there, look at Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1. The main reason why we went over there is to show you that you were appointed on the sufferings and the issue of not being moved. Look at what he says here in Philippians chapter 1. We have the same type issue going on here. Look at verse 27. "Only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ." Now, remember what I just said in Romans chapter 1, that the gospel of Christ, it was just what it was at first, but it becomes a whole bunch of more. Now there's a conversation that we're supposed to have in the gospel of Christ. Because the gospel of Christ didn't just provide us salvation from the debt and penalty of our sins, it's provided us all that we have in Christ. It's provided us this walk after the Spirit. It's provided us the comfort and the hope. That's where it all comes from, the gospel of Christ. And we're supposed to have a conversation as becometh the gospel of Christ. The very thing that all the gospel of Christ has provided, has given us, and that we're learning, that's what we should become. And he says this, he says that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs that ye stand fast. There it is. One spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel, and in nothing terrified by your adversaries. Notice, if you're standing fast and you're one mind and you're striving together for the faith of the gospel, that's going to produce, verse 28, and in nothing terrified by your adversaries, which is to them an evident token of perdition, but to you of what? Salvation. A salvation presently that you're not terrified, and a salvation because we're eventually, our bodies are going to be saved. We're going to be saved from this world, out of this world. And he says, and that of God. The salvation is of God. Look at verse 29. For unto you, and why would we need to, why would it be the salvation? Why would there be the possibility of being terrified by our adversaries? For unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ. What does that mean to you? What does that expression mean to you, verse 29? For unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ. You guys are going to teach me this. Then you'll know exactly what it means. Don't look at what he says there. He says, and unto you it is given. What does that mean? It's yours. It's a gift. And it's a gift in the behalf of Christ. I'm giving you this on the behalf of Christ. Who really gave that to you? Christ. This isn't just something Josh Strzelecki or some other grace preacher is teaching and just conjuring up. I would never in my own thinking would want to teach so much on suffering. That by nature is just not something I like. It's not something I want. It's not something I want to tell people to say that you're going to have to go through. That's not easy. But this is given on behalf of Christ. And look what he's going to say. Not only, that means he's going to at least bring up two things here. Not only to believe on him, but also to what?
To suffer
for his sake. Having the same conflict which you saw in me, and now here to be in me. Really think about that in light of Christianity, in light of what we naturally want to not be given to us. Now, he's not saying, never mind that, but what? Think about that. Think of when people come along. Now, we all naturally don't like to suffer. We want to be delivered from it. You don't need the Spirit of God to want that. What is often taught in other groups of Christianity, of healings and deliverances and those kind of, you don't need the Spirit of God for that. You by nature don't want that. You by nature want the healing. You by nature want the deliverance. You need the Spirit of God and the Word of God to teach you, hey, you're appointed, it's been given to you, but for His sake. God has a purpose and a reason for it. And you got to be able to see that purpose and a reason. You need the Spirit of God with that. Because that's something by nature we don't automatically just think about. And all the while, when we want to be delivered from it, then rather seeing God's purpose in it, we in one sense are neglecting something that Christ has given us. We are neglecting something that Christ has given. Every single time in Christianity, when someone comes along and they're so earnest about being delivered from something and those kind of things, I'm not saying don't change your situation we're not looking for this. We're not trying to stay in it or any of those kind of things. But our attitude and our mindset when we're in it, if we're always looking just to be so out of it instead of being able to think about the hope when we're in it, Because that's exactly the mind of God. That's the mind of Christ. And I've said this before, but back when sin entered the world and death by sin, and even before that, when sin was birthed in Lucifer, and he became the father of it, and God, and he trafficked that in the sanctuaries of the heavenly places. God automatically doesn't go, I gotta change this situation. No, he allows it. And it's one of the greatest, glorious features and characteristics of God. Is that he can operate in it. And he allowed it to take place, and when sin entered the world and death by sin, and all that sin starts coming into play, and all the sufferings come into play that are impacting him as well. Not just them, but him as well. Even more so because he's the creator of all of it. We just have our isolated life that can maybe influence however many people, 100 people. We're his creation. He owns it all. It's all his in that sense. And what he does is he allows it and he works in it. And the greatest manifestation of that capacity and that ability is that cross. And that's one of the most things that brings him glory is his character and his essence and his strength and his power, that he doesn't just have to remove himself from suffering, remove himself from pain, remove himself from hardship. If that were the case, he would have never came and died on that cross for us. Rather, he works within it and does things while it exists. And it's the very thing that's going to bring him, he's glorious intrinsically, but the things that are going to, that bring him glory, that's one of the greatest things that's going to bring him glory. He did all of this, and he's going to get all of this out there because he didn't just faint when sin entered the world and death by sin and suffering and hardship. Rather, it's a testimony of his character and his essence, his power and his strength. And he gives it to us. We don't have to be terrified. We don't have to be fear. We don't have to fret. We don't have to faint. Now, obviously, we have mortal bodies, so there's going to be a physical element that maybe you come to a point where you can't walk anymore, or whatever it might be. So we're not going that far. But generally, in our minds, we don't have to be that. And when our bodies do allow, and our mouth still does allow, we can be charitable, even when we're suffering. Because not of us, but because of God. Because of his word and his power that he, and that the Spirit leads us and he's giving to us in Romans chapter 8. That's what it's doing. It's given to us. And all those that want to get out of the suffering, and that's all that they're concerned about. That's all that they're about, is deliverance and healing and getting out of the situation, get away from it. Not saying there's not a natural component to all that and all those kind of things. We're not masochists and those kind of things. But they don't have the doctrine, the work in them. They are missing out. And the only way you could ever say that is with the Word of God working in you. You're missing out on benefiting from a very glorious aspect of God's character that he wants to conform you into. Look back at Romans chapter 8. So how does this work in God, and how is this designed to work with us? Look at verse 24. For we are saved by hope. That's the salvation. Not to be moved, not to be terrified, not to be affected by the effects of sufferings that can come. We need to be saved from those. Not saved from the situation, because we're going to, God's appointed us, that God allows that so that we can, he can manifest this aspect of himself in us, that we can manifest God in our flesh. That's the mystery of godliness, as Paul tells Timothy. But he does provide a salvation in it, and it's a salvation by hope. One of the things, remember in Romans chapter 8, look what he says there in verse 20. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly. So the creature was made subject to vanity. We went back and we looked at Lucifer when he fell, and he trafficked his iniquity in the sanctuaries of the heavenly places there. And God responded to all that by subjecting it to vanity. And even the angelic realm that didn't go after Lucifer and those who went with him, they're still subject to vanity. What did God immediately do in connection with that? Look what it says. It says, who, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in what? Hope. This isn't exactly the case, but just to get a point across, it's like immediately when that takes place, God does two things. He subjects it to vanity, and then he says, I got to hope for it. He goes, out there, I'm going to do something to it. And one of the things that does in regards to God is it allows him to work amongst in it, knowing that he's got a plan for it out there. He's got a purpose for it out there. And it's going to change out there. And God is faithful, and he's got power. He's going to do it. And one of the things that does for us is that hope that is his, he now gives to us. And what it does for us is it makes it so that we're not moved, we're not terrified, and he's got a purpose for us, and we can be looking at that just as he looks at it. So he says, for we are saved by hope. And he says, but. And what he's going to begin to do here now is going to give some characteristics, in fact, essentially one characteristic, of what hope is. But hope that is what? Seen is not hope. Now there's a few things he's doing here. There's a pattern that Paul is following here. Come with me to 1 Corinthians. I just want to bring this up, and we'll talk about more as we go on, especially in our next section here. If you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2, 1 Corinthians chapter 2. He brings up hope, but he says hope that is seen is not hope. If you can see it now, in other words, if you can possess it now, it's not hope, and you're not going to benefit from that salvation. How can you ever obtain the ability to not be moved in suffering when you never are in suffering, or you always want to be away from suffering? You can't. You can never obtain that. You can never gain that if you're always looking to be away from it. But look what he says here in 1 Corinthians 2. I'll give you a little context here. Let's pick it up in verse 6. He says, howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught, but we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom, which God ordained before the world unto our what? So you got glory here. You got something future, inheritance. You have that in the context here. He says in verse 8, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. And then he says this, and he quotes Isaiah 64, verse 4. And he draws a parallel to what Isaiah said back there. He says, but as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. And then he goes on, verse 10, he says, but God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. Do you know even Israel the very thing that God has prepared for Israel, they're only going to know through the Apostle Paul. We'll deal with that more at another time. But he says three things here. Eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered in the heart of man. Those things comprise our hope. And that are the things that the Spirit has revealed to us. But eye hath not seen them. And people, no wonder people think we're in one sense nuts, right? We haven't seen this. A lot of people say they hear things, but according to Scripture, we don't hear it. It hasn't naturally entered in our heart. We don't have a natural understanding of these things. The only way in which we get to understand, that doesn't mean we don't get to understand it, we don't get to know it, but the only way we do it is through the Spirit teaching us by the Word of God. That's the way in which we get to see it, but not with our physical eyes, with the eyes of our understanding. Not by necessarily the hearing with our ears, unless you read the Word of God aloud, but by revelation. How it enters into our heart is the Spirit of God writing things on our heart. But by nature, we don't get it. And Paul is going to follow that pattern in Romans chapter 8. Look at Romans chapter 8 again. He's going to bring up the eyes there in verse 24. In verse 26, at the end, he says, with groanings which cannot be uttered. If you can't utter something, can you hear it?
Nope.
And he's going to bring up the hearts there in verse 27, and he that searcheth the hearts. We'll talk all about that as we get further on, but the first one he brings up here is the eyes. Is the eyes. And he says, but hope that is seen is not hope. Come over to Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1. And look at verse 15. Then I got to wrap this up here for our first session. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15. Wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of what? Glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of your what? Understanding being enlightened. A different set of eyes. A different set of eyes, I brought this up before, is beginning to be developed here. And that's why when we went back to Proverbs and we saw how a father educates his son, the second thing he does after he wants him to know wisdom and instruction is for him to perceive the words of understanding. Perception being a functionality of understanding as well as the eyes. And wants him to perceive the words of understanding. In Romans chapter 8, when he brings in the detail of our hope, our purpose, the glory, the inheritance, is we're starting to see something with the eyes of our understanding, and God wants us to perceive it because it's attached to the wisdom and instruction that he's going to give us. The wisdom and instruction that we're going to go through now works together for this purpose that he has. And he's going to talk about that as we get further on in Romans chapter 8. But it's these eyes. But if you physically see it, it's not hope. And he goes on and he further explains that in Romans 8 verse 24. He says, for what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? If you see it, if you possess it, if you've got it, there's no more need for hope. And what has Paul attached our hope to? He's attached our hope to the redemption of our body. Our hope will commence and will start to be realized when we'll actually see it with the redemption of our body. We'll put away hope because we'll start to experience it. We'll put away faith because right now we walk by faith, not by sight. And then we'll put away faith. We'll put away hope because we'll begin to actually see it. We'll begin to experience it. We'll get a new body to experience it in. But that's when it takes place and not in between. And then he comes along in verse 25. He says, but if we hope, if we do hope for that we see not, then do we with what? Patience, wait for it. We all got to wait. Christ has to wait. But how Christ is suffering these things and how Christ is waiting for these things is he's doing it patiently. And one of the, I see this directly connecting to verse 17, the issue of suffering with him. is the hallmark component of suffering with Christ is not necessarily suffering the things that he suffers. It's how you suffer them. How you suffer them. And he suffers them patiently. And his hope allows him to suffer these things patiently. And Christ's hope allows him to suffer those things patiently to make sure that he gets what is due out there and the glory out there. And he gives that to us now. So he gives us his hope so that we can suffer these things patiently as well. He comes along and he says, you have a walk after the Spirit. Here's the purpose with it, and here's your hope in connection with it. And what that's designed to produce is patience. Patience. Patience can yield a lot of other things. It's like this hope and then patience and then boom, he can do so many other things when you're patient. My children, I'll end on this and we'll pick this up next session. Bring it back to my children, right? Children sometimes are patient. That's relative. And sometimes, most of the time, they're not. Man, we say we're going to grandma's house or we're saying we're going to the Minnesota Zoo. We went to the Minnesota Zoo on Friday. They can't get anything done. All right, Abby, Sia, you got to put your jackets on. They're off here. They're off there. And they got the excitement and all those things, and rightly so. But as a child, without that patience, they have that hope, and they're so excited about it, but they can't get anything else done. As adults, we're excited. I love the zoo. My wife loves the zoo. We love going to the zoo. We're excited. But we're those adults that have exercised that patience, have patience because it's cold out and we know we got to get snacks. And we know my wife does all that, really. She gets all that stuff and we go out and we put coats on and warming up the car and make sure it's warm for them and exercising these patience and those kind of exercising that patience, and we can get so much more done. And so much of Christianity doesn't have the patience. They have the hope in some form, and they are excited about it and all of that, but they don't have the patience. And they don't get much else done. And what God does is, in one essence, to give you both. You have an earnest expectation. You have such a groaning and such a longing for what is yet to come. But it also works that when you go through hardship, it's going to be worth it. Just be patient. It's going to be worth it. And all over Paul's epistles, he's going to bring that up. And that's where we'll pick it up next session. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time to get into your word and to see the power of this passage. And I pray as we go further and further into it, that we just see it more and more and see the salvation by our hope. And once we have this hope, once we understand it, we get some of these details, and there's a whole lot more yet to come in regards to its details, that we rely upon that salvation, and we experience that salvation when we go through sufferings, and truly have the fruit of that be the reckoning, that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory which shall be revealed in us. And let that yield that patience in us, to be able to participate in some other things while we go through this life and while we go through the sufferings, so that we can be not moved, that we can stand fast, be established, and we can be prepared to do other good works that you have. And therefore, Father, whether we suffer or not, you have provided us the capacity and the ability to be able to do things to your honor and glory. What a privilege and what a provision you have given us. What a hope truly is our blessed hope, and all the details that constitute it are absolutely mind-boggling and are able to take up so much of our time thinking about them, reckoning them, dealing with the subtle nuances and the details so that we can further benefit from these things. We thank you for your word. For Father, these very words are against our nature, but as sons and daughters who have cried, Abba, Father, who want to not have our will, but your will be done, just as your Son, Lord Jesus, cried in the Garden of Gethsemane, we truly want to be led by your Spirit and learn these things and think about these things the way that you present them and the way in which you teach them and the very same way in which you view them and you perceive them and how they operate within you. And so, Father, what a privilege it is to gain your mind and gain your heart when it comes to suffering, when it comes to hope and how they work together to provide that patience in you and how they can work patience in us. We thank you for all this, and we thank you for your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and how that was all manifested, not only when he came to this earth, but when he died on that cross, was buried and rose again. As the writer of Hebrews says, he despised the shame and he endured the cross because of the joy that was set before him, his hope of being at your right hand, not only being present with you, but being at your right hand, and the glory that you are going to reward him with because of him doing what he needed to do and suffering the way in which he suffered, that manifested your character and your essence. So, Father, we thank you for this. It's hard to say thank you, but when we truly want to be like you and operate and do things like you and how that was manifest in your Son, then we are thankful that you have appointed us thereunto, and you have, Christ is, Paul on Christ's behalf has given these things to us. Not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. May we be vessels that glorify you, not only in the easy things of life, but the sufferings of life as well. Lastly, Father, we pray if someone's here listening, if they did not trust that Christ died for their sins, was buried, and rose again, that they would believe that this very moment, and the moment they do, they'll be justified unto eternal life, have all their sins forgiven, past, present, and future, your righteousness be imputed unto them, and they will therefore possess the gift of eternal life. May they believe this very moment. And we thank you for this time of grace giving. To your honor and glory, in Christ's name, amen.